Welcome back. Today we begin our module on analytical technologies. In this module, we'll focus on the applications and tools that are used to store, extract, and analyze data. In our first module, we learned about how events and characteristics in the real world are captured by source systems. In this video, we'll basically pick up where we left off and talk about the various ways in which data can be stored. Given that we're potentially capturing massive amounts of data in our source systems, it's natural to ask, where the heck does all this stuff go? Well, it turns out that each source usually has its own storage system to hold data relevant to that system. Unfortunately, that isn't necessarily ideal for us as analysts for a few reasons. First, it's likely that the source's storage system is optimized for functional performance, not for data extraction and analysis. As an example, you may have seen the terms online transactional processing, or OLTP, and online analytical processing, OLAP, or OLAP. These terms refer to storage systems that are optimized for business operations and transactions versus those that are optimized for analytics. While it's possible to perform analytics on transactional systems, it's often much easier to do it on analytical systems. The second challenge with source storage systems is that they often contain a lot more information than we really need for analytics. It's not uncommon for a source database to contain all sorts of internal working data that really doesn't have a use outside of system operation. We'd prefer not to have to carry all that extra data into our analytical environment. We also need to remember that source systems can be critical to the day-to-day operation of the business. We may not want to risk slowing down or even crashing those systems by allowing direct access to system data by analytical applications. Finally, because source systems often deal with very high volumes of data, they may not store data for very long in order to optimize the overall performance of that system. This means that if we want the data, or some subset of the data, to be available for a longer period of time, we need to grab it and put it in a longer-term storage location. As we mentioned earlier, we do sometimes connect directly to source systems, especially when we need access to real-time data. We might even intercept data as it streams through a connection point. However, a more common solution is to gather data into a separate storage location. This may be a central data repository, where all data is physically co-located. It could also be a virtual repository, where the data is physically located in different places, but appears to the user as though it's in a common location. And it could be a combination of these two things, or a semi-centralized repository. So we've talked a bit about where we store information. Let's change gears a little and talk about how we store information. There are many ways to store data, but here we'll cover the two broad mechanisms that you're most likely to see in the world of analytics: data files and databases. We'll cover a number of common data types in a few minutes, but it's useful to first talk about file systems. A file system is basically just the digital equivalent of an organized file cabinet. I take pieces of information, I put them into a folder, and perhaps put that folder into a larger folder. Think about your own computer. This is how you probably store most things on your PC or Mac. The nice thing about a file system is that I can put pretty much anything I want there and just note its name and location so I can find it later. File systems are attractive in that they can handle all sorts of information, including what we call unstructured data. We can store documents, spreadsheets, pictures, music, video, you name it. The file system doesn't really care what's in the file. The downside of storing data in file systems is that it's not as obvious how I'd access the data, given that it's sitting in a bunch of different file locations. It's also unclear how I perform data analysis on something like a document, photo, or video without some sort of intermediate processing to turn it into something more structured. One important example of a file system is the Hadoop Distributed File System, or HDFS, which is a big data manifestation of the file system concept. HDFS uses massively parallel processing on relatively inexpensive infrastructure to efficiently store very large amounts of information without much regard to the data type. We'll talk a bit more about big data technologies in a later video. So what about the data files themselves? There are many types of data files. Think of all the different extensions that the files on your computer have. But there are a few file types that come up most often in the world of data analytics. The first is what's called a delimited text file. Normally, a delimited text file contains data that represents a two-dimensional table with columns and rows. The data itself is stored as text, with breaks between the columns and rows identified using specific characters or formatting codes called delimiters. The most common delimiters are commas, tabs, and pipes. The pipe is the vertical line character you see on your keyboard. You'll often see comma delimited files with the extension CSV, which stands for comma separated values. Tab and pipe delimited files usually just have the TXT text file extension. The nice thing about text files is that they are understood by a wide variety of systems and analytical tools, so it's pretty straightforward to move data from one environment to another using this file format. A second file type is an extensible markup language, or XML file. XML is a flexible structure of encoding documents and data that was developed in the late 90s, primarily to facilitate data sharing over the internet. However, it has a wide range of applications, from web pages to applications to messaging systems. The nice thing about XML is that it is a common standard, and it allows for a more complex structuring of data than something like a delimited text file. The downside is that it requires a more sophisticated interface to interpret the data and structure it for analysis. A third type of file is a log file. Log files are generally used to capture event data from a system, and are common in machine data, messaging, and web analytics applications. Log files may or may not follow a standard structure, and they generally require something called a parser to read and interpret the file. The advantage of log files is that they are very flexible and can capture just about any data structure you want. However, this comes at the expense of a much more complicated process for reading and using the data. In fact, there are specific software tools that specialize in parsing log files. The last type of data file we'll discuss is really a class of files that are specific to common data analysis tools. Most tools have their own proprietary file formats for storing data, along with other information called metadata, which describes calculations, operations, or other attributes of the data itself. Far and away, the most common of these is the Microsoft Excel spreadsheet file. Even though there are a lot of sophisticated analysis tools out there, the reality is that a disproportionate amount of actual analytical work is done in Excel. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. Just about everyone knows how to do basic operations in Excel, and there are certain things that are quite frankly just easier to do in Excel, making it a very flexible tool for both manipulating and sharing data and analytical results. However, Excel is just one of many specialized file formats. Tools like SAS, SPSS, Tableau, and a whole host of other applications each have their own specific formats for storing data in standalone files. Broadly, this means you may need to use that specific application to open and use those files. But increasingly, applications are opening up a bit and building in the capability to ingest and interpret other file types. It really depends on the tool. Okay, so we've talked about data files. Now let's move on to databases. A database is simply an organized collection of data. When we say database, we're usually referring to both the structure and design of a data environment, as well as the data itself. A database seeks to store data in a more complex way than what could be achieved in a data file. Specifically, a database usually stores a number of different data entities with some unifying information about how those entities are arranged or related. This enables access to a wider array of information in one common environment versus storing that information in multiple data files that may or may not be tied together. Usually, a database is constructed using a database management system, or DBMS. A database management system is a software application used for creating, maintaining, and accessing databases. There are a variety of different types of databases, but far and away the most common is the relational database. In fact, the relational database is so important that we'll spend a later video in this module talking in detail about this type of database, and we'll spend all of Module 3 learning how to extract data from relational databases. The basic concept behind relational databases is that we store information in two-dimensional tables and then define specific relationships among those tables. It turns out that this can be a really efficient and effective way of storing data that is pretty easy to understand, which contributes to its popularity. The idea was developed by a computer scientist named E.F. Codd at IBM in 1969 and 1970. Given that it's been nearly 50 years since then, it's pretty impressive that the relational database remains the dominant paradigm in data storage. That having been said, the relational database is not the only type of database. In fact, there are a number of emerging types of databases that are being used to handle special types of data, store unstructured data, or improve performance in the era of big data. Let's talk about four common alternative databases: graph databases, document stores, columnar databases, and key value stores. A graph database is based on graph theory, or the study of pairwise relationships between objects. These databases tend to work well with highly interconnected data, like relationships between people or locations, and have applications in physical and social network analysis. A document store, as its name suggests, is generally designed to store documents, along with key pieces of metadata describing those documents. It's useful for storing unstructured data or different data types in a way that's a little more useful than a typical file system. Columnar databases are storage mechanisms which seek to improve the performance of data access by focusing on columns of data tables versus the row-based approach of relational database systems. It turns out that when we write information to a database, we usually do it row by row, which makes sense when each row of data represents something like a purchase transaction or a new customer. However, when we extract data from databases, we're usually more interested in summarizing some attribute across all rows. Columnar databases tend to be much more efficient at this type of data extraction operation. Key value stores are a very simple but powerful way of storing data. They store information in very small pairs, typically a key and a value. This method of storing data is very flexible, as it doesn't require the extensive design and structure of other database types. Without getting into too much detail, it turns out that storing data in this way is very efficient, uses less memory, and can be used to achieve very high levels of speed in certain types of operations. However, it also requires more sophisticated programming to manipulate and extract data. So let's recap. We've learned about two broad types of data storage, data files and databases. We talked about file systems and specific file formats like delimited text files, XML files, log files, and application-specific files. We introduced the idea of databases and covered different types of databases like relational databases, graph databases, document stores, columnar databases, and key value stores. As a data analyst, you almost certainly encounter a number of these data storage mechanisms, both data files and databases, and you'll need to understand how to work with them. Unfortunately, we can't cover all of them in this course, but as we mentioned earlier, we will go a bit deeper into relational databases, and in subsequent courses, we'll use Excel and more advanced tools to actually execute different types of analysis.